In this episode, Bob and I are joined by Nate Stiff, who has written and co-written many Sovereign Grace songs, including O Lord, My Rock and My Redeemer, and Turn Your Eyes. Nate tells us how he got involved with Sovereign Grace Music and shares some of the things he's learned through the years as a songwriter. Hey, welcome to Soundless Doctrine. I am David Zimmer.
And I'm Bob Coughlin.
And we are joined by a very special guest.
Yes,
Nathan Stiff.
Hello.
So good to thunderous applause.
Yeah.
For those of you who don't know, Nathan Stiff, one, is a good friend of David's and mine. So
yes,
that should be enough for me really to get him by.
Yeah, that's it.
Nathan has, or Nate, as we sometimes call him, has been writing songs for Sovereign Grace for quite some time. The most, I think, well-known being O Lord, My Rock and My Redeemer, which was on the Prayers of the Saints album.
Great song.
Is, works for Ernie Ball.
Yes,
and
sir.
What do you do for Ernie Ball?
I oversee global sales for them.
Wow, that sounds so impressive.
It sounds like galactic sales.
Universal sales.
Yeah.
And you live?
I live in the Coachella Valley, California, where the Coachella Music Festival happens.
Festival, not the conference.
Not the conference.
Okay, because I tend to think of things as conferences, but it's the festival. And
very
you
festive.
Have a family.
I do. Wife and 3 kids, under 6. So it's a full house.
That is a full
for sure.
House.
Busy house.
It is.
Well, we are so glad that you could join us today.
It's so
well, thank you so much for having me.
I would love for people to know, we would love for people to know just how you became connected with Sovereign Grace, because Nate is not a part of a Sovereign Grace church, but has been writing songs for us for a number of years. So just how did that relationship develop?
So probably back in 2011 is when I first really started being exposed to Sovereign Grace Music through the pastor at the church where I was leading.
Oh, wow.
As I had become to sort of fall in love with Reformed theology and the writing of the Puritans, I was looking...
Doctrines of grace.
Absolutely. Song, and just that made me realize how beautiful a gospel is.
Yes, yes.
And how,
which I think is the right effect of the doctrines of grace, of God's sovereignty. You realize this is so beautiful.
And also how wretched of a sinner I am.
Yeah, that's
and how,
included.
And how just that the cross needed to be so central to everything we do as a church when we gather. And was struggling to find songs that were communicating all the things that I was becoming excited about the atoning work of Christ on the cross and what that means for everything. And my pastor, David Palmer, at the time said, you know, you should check out Sovereign Grace Music. Mm. And it was really the Gathering album
2011
that I listened to, and I said, this is what we're missing.
Huh.
Because every song was so full of truth that not like, like as you say, as you've said, sometimes a theological fire hydrant, but it was the lyrics
try to avoid that.
Beautifully communicating the truth of the gospel and why Jesus is so glorious and needs to be central to everything that we do when we gather. And so, and they were also songs that we could play. Like, they were accessible. They weren't crazy. The arrangements weren't, they were, obviously because of super gifted musicians, the arrangements were.
Yeah, David,
were,
you played on that album.
He did.
Drums.
I did. That was a great
he
album.
He did. And your drumming, still watching you drum is one of my favorite things to do.
Mine as well.
Yeah. And so it was that album that introduced me to Sovereign Grace Music, and then I went back and listened to the Psalms album, and I just sort of stayed in it.
Wow. And okay, so how did you start writing?
Well, I've always loved writing songs, and I started.
Did you write as a kid?
I did actually. Oh, okay. I mean, I have memories of having a little tiny piano and just chaotically
well
slamming on it and writing songs. I mean,
I can tell what kind of pianist you are just by the way you did that.
Very much so. Yeah. Like Muppet Babies. Anyway.
Not a good one.
I didn't really understand how to craft a congregational song.
Okay. So you were writing like love songs or Christian songs?
Very much so.
Everything. Okay.
both.
Okay.
And sometimes hard to tell the difference. Yeah. Yes.
There are those kinds of songs.
And so I started writing, and I went to, you guys had a micro gathering conference on the West Coast.
Oh, Worship God Conference.
Yeah, it was a small little.
In Orange.
And we took the whole worship team and we went, and it was transformative for all of us.
Oh,
seeing all of this, like, come together and be done so well, and hearing your heart for why what we do on Sundays matters so much, and why the gospel has to be at the forefront, and how the gospel shapes our gatherings. And we all just walked away from that conference.
Oh, man, I had no idea.
Transformed with a new set of priorities and really passion to see the gospel be the priority. And because of, working.
Let me just insert something right there. I remember that conference. It was so last minute. I think we advertised it for like a month and a half or a month. I don't know. We got there, just had very little time to practice. And it just felt like, let's just kind of pull this thing together. But to hear how God uses that, our labors, our efforts to glorify His name and to bring about that change.
Yeah, yeah.
That's so kind of the Lord.
Yeah, and so humbling.
It's very
that
humbling.
He does that. Just despite our efforts. And energy.
Well, you could have fooled us because it.
Well, good. Amen.
It was great. Working for a company that makes guitar stuff, I connected with Joel Sabel, who's also a songwriter.
He's written a number of songs.
Mm-hmm. And would play on the albums. And we just started talking. And after that conference, I remember going home and praying, Lord, if there's any way I could ever get involved with Sovereign Grace Music, that'd be great. I mean, that was probably the prayer. Like, it was really just like, that'd be swell.
So God. Sick.
Yeah. So, yeah. Probably. And 2 weeks later, Pat Sabel, Joel's dad, who's written another...
Jesus, thank you.
His Forever. Walked through the doors of the church where I was leading the music. And we happened to be doing one of his son's songs that morning.
Perfect.
And I was like... And it didn't even click for me at the beginning. Like, my answer to prayer is just walked into the sanctuary.
So random.
Thank you, Lord. It was like, what's happening? Like, Pat, why is Pat, why are you here? Why are you here? Like, why are you in the desert?
Because literally you live in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, I do. his family that live in, Joel's in-laws had a house down the street.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, God sovereignly ordained their real estate purchase to get me involved at Sovereign Grace Music.
God can do anything he wants.
And he does. And so I started kind of writing with Pat and connecting with Pat. And I asked Joel, I've got a song that I think is good. How do I, what do I do with it?
Confidence there.
And he said, well, send it to me and I'll get it over to Bob. And that first song that I submitted was a version of Emmanuel, Glory in the Highest, that's on.
Which we put on Heaven Has Come,
yeah.
The Christmas album we just did.
And it was much different.
I think I remember that a little bit.
Yeah.
It being much different.
It was.
Yeah. I think I remember hating that.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for writing.
And so.
Wanting to serve the church.
And so that song has sort of served for me as a picture of even as of my evolution as a and growth as a songwriter because of your diligence and patience and investment.
Well, which we want to talk about your growth as a songwriter. But before that, you guys have written a lot of songs together, especially a lot for the Glorious Christ album. But tell us how you started writing songs and what that process has been like.
Yeah, I mean, we met at a conference, one of the Worship God conferences. And I mean, just became friends. And I think just enjoying one another's company kind of progressed us into, hey, you write a lot of lyrics and I tend to write a lot of melodies. And I think the first thing that we ever worked on that you ever sent me was, a Christmas hymn that you were writing that I mentioned talking about in the... a lot of the Heaven Has Come promo that we did was that I read these lyrics and was so struck by the poetry, the truth, the beauty in it, and just the progression of the gospel, like starting with the incarnation and rolling through. And this is Jesus, God triumphant. Mm. I just was so struck that it didn't take long to write a melody to. I think I threw it back to you.
In like 15 minutes after I sent the lyrics to you. You were at the Sing conference and you like walked out.
I voice memoed.
You walked out of whatever thing you were in and recorded a voice memo and sent that over.
I think I voice memoed the lyrics back to you. But I just think it just like clicked quickly. And there's some times when you write songs with people and it doesn't click. Doesn't mean you quit, but there are also sometimes people that you write with and it just clicks. You know?
Yeah.
And so I think that was with you, Nate. And so we just decided to start co-writing every Tuesday at that point.
Wow. Yeah.
I came to a songwriter's retreat and we brought a couple songs to the songwriter's retreat. And then it just became that sort of habitual pattern.
Hmm.
And I just think for my soul, for my faith, for my growth was so instrumental. Also, just in my songwriting too. But just to do life with a person.
Hmm.
Week by week, you build that trust, that vulnerability.
Which is really important.
And we also just have a blast. Like, we also just crack jokes.
80% joke, 20% writing.
And dork around a lot and laugh. And so I think it brings a brevity, too, of that it's not like we are crafting the, you know, it's like
the worship hit.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. We're doing life together. Mm. And yeah. I've benefited from that so much. But
you've been faithful. I mean, you did that for a number of years, right?
Yeah, we did that for a few years. We were very consistent.
I mean, 3 years.
We both have young kids, and so sometimes our children got in the way of our writing.
Yes. Well, they'll do that. They'll get in the way of a lot of things.
And got to enjoy just getting to – that was really loud. Great.
Well done.
Ta-da. Just getting to know you as a person, not just for, you know, you as a melody writer, but you as just.
Yeah. So talk about that co-writing process. What do you do? You're on a Zoom call. What do you do? What happens? Hey, I got some lyrics. Hey, have you already worked on it? What's happening?
Well, it really depends. I mean, sometimes the starting place is different. Sometimes the starting place was David had would have a compelling melody and like, hey, here's where this came from. And so we talk about a little bit about the emotion that he felt while crafting that melody. So to sort of get an understanding for the tone that the lyrics needed to take, right? That, or sometimes it was, hey, I've got these lyrics and here's what I'm feeling. Here's why I wrote these lyrics. Yes. And so that would sort of inform where the melody would go. Yeah. And
there's no defined formula to the process. But I think, it's a lot of the variables you're talking about. But what I've really appreciated in our song and our co-writing is a slogan we use a lot of just best idea wins.
Yeah.
And I really like that in terms of like not all melody ideas have to come from me. Mm. Not all lyric ideas have to come from you.
Yeah, yeah.
But just best idea wins. We're serving this song for the purpose of serving others.
Big time.
So that's if they so can good. Sing it better, if it's clearer lyrically.
Yeah.
And so sometimes you have to speak up and be bold and not you know,
you're just being honest
with each other.
And when the relationship's there, there's you don't ever feel threatened or you don't ever feel like you're being cheated out of an opportunity to have something
that you wrote.
You really trust the other person.
Yeah.
And all you have to do is say, hey, I like that or I don't like that. It's not like there's some right answer.
Right, right.
This whole conversation reminds me of that passage in 1 Corinthians 12, you know, just where the best idea might come from you. Mm-hmm. David, best idea might come from you, Nate. And hardly ever comes from me. I've noticed that. But that's another conversation. What Paul says when he's talking about spiritual gifts are, in verse 11, he says, all these different kinds of gifts are empowered by one and the same Spirit, chapter 12, verse 11, empowered by one and the same Spirit, who apportions to each one individually as he wills.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like none of us has a market, or no one has a market on the Spirit's like working. Certainly, we develop our craft. We seek to do the best we can. Certainly, you know, you are very gifted in melodies. You are very gifted in lyrics. But the Spirit is the source, not us. So the Spirit might use someone else to come up with a better melody, even though I'm a melody guy. I just see that process working.
Yeah, that's really well said. And I think looking out of that lens of that it's the Spirit that's inspiring this, it makes it easier to write with someone else.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it makes it easier to take criticism. I mean, anyone that's listening to this podcast that either writes a ton of songs or is just trying to get into songwriting, I would encourage them to have people that you trust help edit your songs.
Yes, yes.
Your melodies. I wouldn't rely on your church body to do that
in
on
general.
A Sunday morning.
I just love your song. I love your song. I love your song. I love your song.
Or no one's singing because I can't sing it. In when you have the opportunity to have someone you trust edit your content, you grow in this understanding of, oh, this isn't as good as I thought it was.
Yeah,
this could be better.
I don't know if you can really – I mean, I think you'll grow in certain ways, just like anything you practice and you tend to get better at. But if you don't have somebody that can – help you see where something's weak or even where it's strong, you're not going to get much better or you're going to go in like one direction and you might even be making your weaknesses weaker.
Yeah.
You might be developing worse habits. And so you
need, that's good.
But like we need community for everything and songwriting can't be excluded from that. Like we're not meant to be alone in anything that we do. And so we need other voices speaking and also helping us to be sensitive to the Spirit because, again, if a song resonates, it's because God decreed it to resonate.
God made it resonate.
God made it resonate. And because Jesus is glorious and he's worth singing about and because the Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is the Spirit that 'll make a song minister.
Amen. Amen. Mm. And yet God does use means.
Yes.
And I think it'd be helpful if anyone listening is a songwriter, I think we probably do have a lot of songwriters listening, to talk about, Nate, what are some of the things that you've done to grow, to cooperate with what God's doing? I think you've grown lyrically. I think you've grown in your heart, you know, just the way you approach songwriting. I remember some of the early retreats. I think you've been on about 5 or 6, I don't know. Early retreats, you were much more aggressive in terms of...
Can I
be part of the song? Hey, can I be part of the song?
I have things to say that people need to hear now.
Exactly.
Hey, I named your song for you.
But close.
That's really changed. I think your writing has gotten better without question. What have you pursued to do that? How has that happened, practically?
I think because we're explicitly gospel focused in what we're writing about, that the more you do that, if you're not being humbled as a songwriter, then something's off.
That's good. Say that again. If you're not being humbled as a songwriter,
because the more you're, they say songs are sermons people remember, right?
Yeah.
And so as we're writing a song from taking it, a lot of it from Scripture, the Word of God is sinking in deeper, or should be, because we're trying to creatively communicate this. And so just that process of doing that regularly has caused the Word of God to dwell in me more richly. Mm. And I think that He has graciously shown me areas where I've been prideful or overbearing or just immature in a lot of ways.
So are you more conscious of trying to write lyrics? Because you write some very creative lyrics.
Mm-hmm.
Are you more conscious of trying to write them in a way that, that comes from Scripture?
Yes.
That represents scriptural themes and priorities? And
And that tries to frame them in a way that, you know, just gets you to be like, oh, that's a different way of saying that. That'll stick with me. Good. And I think as far as processes are concerned, it's just, I don't have a particular process. Like, I don't say, like, on Wednesdays from 4 to 8, 6 p.m., I just don't. I'm sort of like, I've sort of tried to be like flypaper for ideas, so that always just be, anticipate inspiration.
That's good.
One thing is that you just don't necessarily like hunker down and be like, all right, inspiration, like, come to me. It's more like just be open to it and train yourself to recognize things that are that can serve as fuel for songwriting. Huh. Hmm. And so be that in your time.
So, like, how do you do that? That's so mystifying to me. Recognize things that could serve as inspiration. Because you do both. I mean, when you get locked into a song, you are locked in and you're kind of doing it all the time. You're just thinking
that's
all the time.
Yeah, I mean, and that comes, that's sort of a, I mean, it's
who you are.
It's a personality,
it's a gift.
Gift and curse, you know. I mean, because we'll be, if there's a song that I care about and that's interesting to me and I'm working on, like, it bangs around my head all day to the point where, like, I'll be at dinner and I'll just suddenly, like,
Jonna will
kind of stare off into the distance, and Jonna will say, she won't even ask me. She just knows. She says, "You're writing a song, aren't you?" And I'm like, done. Like,
what?
Like, the computer has to reset a little bit. Yeah. And so,
But you also schedule things. Like, you have written with me on Fridays. I mean, it's been sporadic, but it's only been sporadic because I, like, cop out. I mean, I say, you know, you'll text me, hey, are we on for this week? And I'm thinking, oh, man, I could use that. But you are persistent, and it's so good because that's how songs get written.
Mm. The staying consistent, I mean, I think that with anything that you want to grow in is important.
Yeah,
I mean,
you
can't eat one healthy meal a week and, like, expect it to really change your body chemistry.
I do get people who, well, I mean, I'm sure other people do, you know, I've written one song. Here it is.
Yes.
You know, if you want to use it in your congregation, just let me know. And I'm thinking, oh, man, do you realize how many songs people write to get to a place where other people do their songs?
Yeah, yeah.
You have to, I mean, write a lot and co-write a lot and co-write with as many people that think about melody and lyric differently than you do.
Yes, that's good.
Because it will grow you. I think in your that's book, Worship good. Matters, I mean, you say practice what you're bad at. Don't practice what you're good at. Then you're just like the guy from Lady in the Water that just works out his right arm, and he just has this massive right arm, and the rest of his body's just like.
I'm sorry, what was that reference?
Anyway, not important. Moral of the story is versatility as a writer too, I think, is really important, and surrounding yourself with people that are better than you, and wanting to not be the best writer in the room, wanting to be surrounded
that's
by people,
because you might be. I mean, in a certain area, you might be the best.
Sure.
Whatever. Lyricist, melody person.
But try to. I mean, you can learn something from every songwriter to some degree.
Well, and you're constantly growing,
You have to.
But you've modeled that. I mean, I've just seen that. You're one of the guys who is, I think, so freely gives credit to other songwriters. In other words, there's when you write a song, there's this process of, okay, is that idea worth something? Is that idea worth a part of the song? Like, do I get an author's, you know, a composer's credit for that? You know, and we've tried to cultivate the mindset: be quick to give credit, be slow to take credit.
Yeah,
and you really model being quick to give credit.
Well, when your ideas are the ones
that, what you wanted to say wasn't very important. Go ahead.
Yeah. I'm modeling this well right now.
You are doing a terrible job.
When the lyrics that end up, or the melody that ends up being recorded, don't exist without all the other iterations before it.
No, that's right. That's exactly right.
And so it's like there's a whole framework that was built underneath this thing.
Yes,
and
yes.
You're seeing the finished product, but the best idea comes after lots of great ideas.
It sits on the shoulder, stands on the shoulders of a lot of other ideas that never made it to the top.
And your first idea is never usually your best.
That's good.
Well, and we're talking a lot about just a spirit of humility when you're approaching songwriting and co-writing. But I think even just practically, it kind of goes hand in hand that if you write one song, you're bound to be more offended because you've put all the blood, sweat, and tears and energy into that one song.
Yeah.
As opposed to, I've written these 100 songs. And so I can give a little bit here, and I can give a little bit here. And I can, and so you're sort of like diversifying, which just has less impact. You're just trying, how can I serve these the best?
Yeah. You know,
and not just hold so white knuckle onto this one song that has to get on the album or something.
And I think when you write like 100 songs or hundreds of songs, you realize how many bad songs you can actually write.
Exactly.
Oh, gosh. Yeah.
And so it makes you a little humbler.
There are. I mean, David and I mean, for ahead of The Glorious Christ, you and I wrote 30 or 40 songs.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think you guys had a majority of the songs on that album. But yeah, you did. You wrote like six times as many songs as are actually on there.
And it's not that you're half writing them. You're trying to complete them with hooks, with melodies.
The whole thing. Yeah.
So it is just a practice and an energy. But Nate, you've just been such a blessing to Sovereign Grace Music and to my life. And I hope this is encouraging for anybody who's listening to keep writing and to keep finding people that will edit with you and for the glory of the Lord so that we can serve his people.
So just before it sounds like you're landing the plane, but just before we do that, O Lord, my Rock, my Redeemer, beautiful song. It's blessed people throughout the world. Mm-hmm. Did that just kind of come out of you?
I mean... Yeah, it sure did. And what came out first wasn't great. It was, you never know what a song is going to do. Like you never set out to saying this song is going to really minister to people. Hopefully not. Yeah,
hopefully not.
But I was reading Psalm 19. I loved how it ended with "O Lord, my Rock and my Redeemer," and I Googled "O Lord, my Rock and my Redeemer"
you gotta start
song, and there wasn't much. And I said, well, here we go.
Less competition.
Yeah. And started off with the right motivation, for sure. But just wanting to unpack those three things, Lord, Rock, that's Redeemer. Good. And the originally had a melody that was not compelling, and I sent it to you, and you said, it's good, but it's not great.
Mm-hmm. And there are gazillion melodies like that.
Good,
but not great.
Yeah, yeah.
So your church might love it.
Yeah.
But it's not going far beyond that.
Yeah, yeah.
And then God orchestrated some very difficult circumstances for me and my family. Hmm. And got to go back to the song and say, what would it sound like if I sang it like I meant it?
Oh, that's so good, Nate.
That's really good.
That's how we should write every song.
It is.
And so what came out of that was just there was pain but hope and that's what I tried to convey with the melody, because it was a melody that I definitely, more so than I think any other that I've written, it was a melody that I felt. Felt that in that season.
Well, it sounds like more of a cry than a, hey, these fit the words.
It's a catchy tune.
Yeah. But when you have a melody that sort of is just a deep cry from your soul, it translates, because people sing that song at all different places. Hmm. Sometimes it's boosting their confidence and their hope in Christ, and sometimes it's a confession.
Yeah. Well, it contains both. I think that's one of the reasons it's so effective, is it?
Yeah.
It's, you know, my song when
enemies surround me,
my hope when tides of sorrow rise, my joy when trials are abounding. You get to express both.
Yeah, that's
good. Right
now,
I'm faced by enemies, trials, challenges, but Jesus is my joy. Mm. He's my song. He's my hope. And then you tie it all. You bring it all home with, this is the greatest thing. He died for my ruined life, and he's risen.
Yeah.
And thank you for writing that song. Thank you for being faithful. Thank you for being with us today. And
thank you.
Amen. Yeah. Thanks, Nate. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you for listening to Sound Plus Doctrine, the podcast of Sovereign Grace Music. Sovereign Grace Music exists to produce Christ-exalting songs and training for local churches from local churches. For more information, free sheet music, translations, and training resources, you can visit us at sovereigngracemusic.org.